Hello students, so we'll go for the next concept of class 13 of magnetic properties. Okay, so we will have some magnetic phenomena in one dimensional crystal. Okay, so if you see here, so we'll take one by one here some conditions like this, the movement of the electrons here. Okay, so like this, any type, this one electron, so this such type of alignment of the electrons we call it as a paramagnetic, we know that. Okay, then there will be the second phenomena of having the electrons alignment in very particular way, so this we call it as a ferromagnetic. Then we have the exact anti-parallel, this, so we call it anti-ferromagnetic. Okay, anti-ferromagnetic. Okay, so where we can see that one is plus half, minus half, plus half, minus half. Then we are also having some like this. Okay, so like this. Okay, so where we can having haphazard way, plus half, minus half, plus half, plus half, plus half, minus half, minus half, plus half, like this. That is your ferromagnetic. Ferromagnetic. Then we have somewhat in this way, plus half, minus half, plus half, minus half, like this. Okay, yes, minus half, or sometimes like this, or plus half, minus half, like this. Okay, so you can see here, in here, so you are going to see that so these plus half, then minus half is there, then here you can see two parallel here like this, so here something like this. Okay, so here what happened, you can see here spin glass, here's a spin glass behavior. So this is spin glass behavior. Okay, spin glass behavior, where you can see the anti-ferromagnetic array, where the anti-ferromagnetic array, okay, where the anti-ferromagnetic array disrupted, okay, by ferromagnetic coupling. Okay, so here anti-ferromagnetic is a plus half, minus half, plus half, minus half, but here you can see both are here. That is what the spin glass behavior we say, where the anti-ferromagnetic array is disrupted. Here anti-ferromagnetic is disrupted by the ferromagnetic coupling here, like this. Okay, so this is one the magnetic property will be there. Then in some in some case you can see here, so like this, it starts from like this. Okay, then like this. Okay, it will take one turn this way, then this way, something this way, like this. Okay, that means one round turn it is taking, like this. Okay, one round type of this is taking in this way, alignment. Okay, and such type of this we call it as a heli magnetism. Okay, like this. These are the different magnetic phenomena in 1D dimensional here. Now if you see the graphical presentation of all this, so you can show like this. Okay, so where you can see this is zero here, so here chi inverse, and this is a theta, this is also zero, this also comes here theta here. So this is Curie-Weiss law for ferromagnetism. Okay, and this is your Curie's law paramagnetism, and this is also Curie-Weiss law for anti-ferromagnetism. Okay, so this graph is reciprocal of temperature in Kelvin versus reciprocal of your magnetic susceptibility, chi, magnetic susceptibility. Okay, so see here, you can see in this here versus temperature for substance. Okay, there are that are paramagnetic in nature. Most of this you can see the substances are paramagnetic nature, like this, which are passing from exactly zero here. So they may show the magnetic ordering at a low temperature. Okay, slope always it remains to be C inverse. Okay, concentration inverse here, slope is equal to C inverse. Okay, that is Curie's inverse here. And if you see the ordered magnetic structure, they lose their ordered structure above some temperature. So whatever the ordered magnetic, this will be there, they lose their ordering here above some temperature. So that temperature we call it as a Curie's temperature, TC, or Neel temperature, that is your TN. Okay, TN means whatever Neel temperature, and TC is nothing but Curie's temperatures. Okay, ordering, they there is some breakup of the ordering, they lose their order structure above such temperatures. Okay, so this is, and this usually this Curie's temperature, so this is referred for ferro and ferrimagnetic, and this Neel temperature, this is for the antiferromagnetic. Okay, this is for the antiferromagnetic and helimagnetism. So this is how. Okay, in most of the paramagnetic substance, so if you see here, the most of the paramagnetic substance here, they may obey simple Curie's law, which is given as chi is equal to C by T. Okay, that means inversely proportional to temperature. Okay, magnet susceptibility is inversely proportional to the temperature, and where C is what? Curie's constant. Okay, this is nothing but your Curie's constant. Okay, so when a spontaneous interaction between the adjacent spin, okay, if you see as adjacent spin will be there, so when a spontaneous interaction between the adjacent spin, which develops into ordered magnetic structure here at a low temperature, okay, or at a high temperature. Okay, at a high temperature you can see here, so that is we call it as a Curie's whistle of a ferromagnetic nature. Okay, so that is this one, and if a low temperature you can see here, so that is your Curie's whistle law for the antiferromagnetic structure, which is given by C is equal to C by T minus theta. Okay, this is called your Curie's whistle law. Okay, so where theta is vis constant, theta is a vis constant, and if you plot this paramagnetic here, the tendency to magnetic order here, so if you plot extrapolated to zero here, you can see here, so for chi, then for the chi, which is given for the paramagnetic nature here, okay, so which is passing from the zero. Okay, so magnetic order, so it is passing to zero by, where you can see the chi value here higher for the simple paramagnetic. Okay, for if you see for this ferromagnetism, so it is high. If you see here, that becomes high from the simple paramagnetic nature for this Curie's whistle law, and for antiferromagnetic, if you see, so infinitely you can see it becomes infinite at chi. Chi is less than zero. Okay, chi inverse is less than zero at you can see like this. Okay, so it is coming here low temperature, so this is what happens here. And in paramagnetic substance which shows, okay, that shows the tendency of antiferromagnetic order, so if you see here, this is what, so okay, the paramagnetic substance, but they are showing the antiferromagnetic, some of the substance below, that's what we call as TN. This is a Neel temperature, below temperature, and this is your TC, that is above the temperature, that is Curie's temperature. So they are showing the ferromagnetic nature from the paramagnetism, and this is some substance, they show antiferromagnetic nature below the Neel temperature. Okay, below the Neel temperature from the paramagnetic nature. So this happens. Okay, so this is how we can see this graphical presentation is explained in this way. Now if you see some of the graphs here, so I will go for the next this one to understand some of the magnetic behavior. So we'll show for some of the graphs. Okay, so this, so you can take it one graph here, three graphs we'll discuss here. So this is your temperature, which is named to the Curie's temperature here, and you can take it this from 0, okay, 0.2, 0.4, 0.6, 0.81, here also you can take it here, 0.2, 0.4, 0.6, 0.81, okay, and this is nothing but your relative saturation of magnetization, relative saturation of magnetization relative saturation of magnetization versus temperature. You can see here, so something it goes like this, like this, like this, and lastly it goes constant here. Okay, this is for your nickel iron, like this. Okay, so what is having here, there are some of the properties. So in this case you can see some property of ferromagnetic behavior here, some property of ferromagnetic material. Okay, where you can see here, here the saturation magnetization, relative saturation magnetization to absolute here at absolute zero here. Okay, as absolute zero, as a function of reduced temperature, as a function of reduced temperature. Okay, so you can see that as the temperature is here, so you can see there is a saturation is increased at one point, and after one point you can see there is a constant here. Okay, so this is how it comes here. Okay, to one point the saturation is very magnetization is increasing, and one point it comes to the constant. Okay, so this is what we can see, some of the ferromagnetic material is showing at a reduced temperature. Okay, so one more thing you can see here, if you take another graph here with the temperature degree centigrade, so here 0 you can take it here, then here 400, 600, 800, like this. Okay, temperature degree centigrade, and here concentration 2 × 10⁴, 4 × 10⁴, 6 × 10⁴, 8 × 10⁴, 10 × 10⁴. Okay, some small deviation will be there here, like this, and then you can show in this, like this. Okay, so this is for nickel here, and if you see this one case here, so where we are plotting here chi inverse, now this x-axis is your chi inverse versus temperature here. So small deviation you can find here, near to 400 here, then constant increase will be there here. And here you can see this is Curie-Swiss law. So here this graph is explained by Curie-Swiss law. Okay, this graph is Curie-Swiss law plot for nickel. Okay, for nickel of inverse susceptibility x minus versus inverse susceptibility. Okay, that is your inverse susceptibility against temperature. Okay, which shows small deviation here near TC. So this is your TC. Okay, at Curie's temperature, small deviation you can see here. It's not exactly cutting here. Small deviation will be there. And above this Curie's temperature, you can see it is showing very high magnetic susceptibility here. Okay, small deviation will be there here in near the TC here, like here. Okay, so here you can see up to here there is a little increase here, but afterwards there is a constant here. That means it goes to the paramagnetic behavior. Okay, after from here to here, so you can see there is small correct increase in this, but after this reduced pressure temperature process here, so you can see a constant value. These all things the ferromagnetism shows, and with different graphical method. Here it is relative saturation of magnetization. Okay, once there is saturation of magnetization, then everything it comes to be constant in nature here. Okay, as a function of temperature, as a function of temperature. In this case we are taking temperature versus inverse susceptibility. So here also you can see near to TC there is a deviation here. Okay, upon deviation you can see there is a linear increase in the susceptibility here. Okay, so this also is there, and one more plot we can show it here. Okay, one more plot like this. Okay, and this plot will be again temperature in Kelvin here. So 200 400 600 800 1000, like this. Okay, and this is your specific heat, what is joules per mole per Kelvin. Now if you see this, something it comes in this way, like this. Okay, and this is your TC, this is your TC, and this is for your iron. So this we can say that here in this plot, heat capacity, Cp is nothing but heat capacity, heat capacity. Okay, so heat capacity you can see here of iron, Fe. Okay, we have plotted as a function of temperature here, and at TC you can at TC, at Curie's temperature, you can see there is a large increase in the heat capacity, again coming down to the then here. So this is what the three graphs are there, which shows the different nature of the end of the, what you say, the ferromagnetic property. Okay, ferromagnetic material, how they are going to show the deviations with respect to that temperature as soon as they reach, that is your Curie's temperature here, and here the x and y axis, you can see we have shown here in a different characterizations, like here relative of saturated magnetization versus temperature, here susceptibility, that is inverse of susceptibility versus temperature, here heat capacity versus temperature. In all the case, you can see here near to Curie's temperature, you can see there is a breakup of the ordering management of the electrons, and you can see a different type of magnetic behavior is shown by this elements, okay, by this ferromagnetic materials. So this is what, okay, and this Bohr magneton, whatever this is there, it is given by EH by 4 pi mc, okay. So Bohr magneton is represented by EH by 4 pi mc, where E is nothing but your electron charge, okay, electron charge. H is Planck's constant, m is electron mass, mass of the electron, n, okay, m is the electron mass here, mc is a velocity of light, like this, okay. And for a simple electron, single electron, so this magnetic moment is given by g into root of s into s plus 1, you know that, okay, where g is called gyrometric, okay, gyromagnetic ratio, g is the stands for gyromagnetic ratio, okay. So this is how we can show the magnetic moment value here. And in case of orbital, if you see in the case of orbital moment, if it makes full contribution, so if orbital moment is here, spin only moment is there, here orbital moment, if it makes full concentration, then what it becomes now, the mu s plus l, contribution from spin and orbital, so it becomes into 4s into s plus 1 plus l into l plus 1, you know this, okay, where l is what, l is nothing but orbital angular momentum quantum number, this is your orbital angular momentum quantum number, so this L, okay. So this is what in a very brief way we have learned this in the third semester also, so that is not required now, this much you can keep in the mind. Now next we'll go for the very important, that is your mechanism of ferro and antiferro ordering, okay, that's called super exchange phenomena. So here what we are going to learn is in the paramagnetic state, okay, individual magnetic moment of ions we are going to learn here. So we can take the example of nickel oxide. So one diagram you can show here like this, okay. So this is nothing but your Ni plus 2, this is nothing but your O2 minus, and this is nothing but your Ni plus 2 here. So you can see that this is the overlap here, where the electron is like this, plus half here, it will be ordering will be negative, minus half again here, you can see this is your plus half, and this will be your, so antiferro, that's why it's a mechanism of ferro and antiferromagnetic nature we are learning here. And this is antiferromagnetic coupling, okay. So this you can say nickel is there, so this is the p orbital, that is your pz orbital of oxide here, and this is dz square orbital of your nickel, okay. This is what, and this overall figure is for the antiferromagnetic coupling of d electrons of Ni plus 2 through p electrons of O minus 2, okay. So this is antiferromagnetic coupling of spin of d electrons of Ni plus 2, this is nickel, plus 2 through p electrons of the pz orbital electrons of the O minus 2, okay. So this is how we can show how it has been so aligned here. So Ni plus 2 d orbital z is plus half, then pz orbital will be minus half, plus half, minus half. So see how very nicely they have been arranged here, okay. So some force is there which is making them to arrange in this way, plus half, minus half, like this. It could be how like this also, but some force is there which is, that's what here the mechanism of ferro and antiferro ordering, super exchange we call it, that process we call it as a super exchange, okay. So what happens here? Now, in this case, what happens, the the containing these unpaired electrons. Okay, they are oriented at, usually they are oriented at the random. Okay, so they are oriented at random. So any of this material, magnetic moment of ions. Okay, now if you see this any materials which contain the unpaired electrons, they are oriented at random. This is important here, random. And you can see partial alignment occurs, and when they are in random they will be like this. Okay, and when partial alignment occurs, okay, when it occurs, partial alignment, when you apply the magnetic field. So here the energy of interaction between, so what happens here, the energy of interaction between dipole and magnetic field, dipole and magnetic field, okay, so calculated. So when we calculate this energy of interaction and dipole or between the dipole and magnetic field, so energy, this will be what you say, it was found to be greater, okay, more value was found here than the thermal energy KT, greater than the thermal energy KT. Okay, so this is what, okay, so this possessed by the ions, thermal energy of KT possessed by the ions or dipoles. Okay, so whatever the energy of interaction between dipole and magnetic field was found, it was greater usually than the thermal energy KT which was possessed by the ions or the dipoles. Okay, this is what experimental data is found here. Okay, and usually in the ferro and antiferromagnetic substances, in ferro and antiferromagnetic substances, the alignments of the magnetic dipole was occurring simultaneously. Okay, so here in ferro antiferro states, what happens, the alignments of the magnetic dipoles was occurs simultaneously, magnetic and dipoles. Okay, so there must be some positive energy. So why they are aligning simultaneously, as we have seen in the diagram here. So there must be some, I said no one, this is, and this will be there here. So that shows that there must be some positive energy. This is very much, there must be some positive energy of interaction between neighboring ions or the electrons that allows this to occur either parallel or anti-parallel. So either it will occur like this, it makes them to either occur parallel like this or anti-parallel like this. So this is what happens here. Okay, so two conditions are there, that positive energy may make the neighboring electron like this, here on electron, either to align anti-parallel or parallel. So this is how is important. So that is this here happens here. Okay, so then some positive energy will be there, and the origin of this coupling of spin or cooperative interaction is quantum mechanical. We call this as a quantum mechanical. So this is very much important. Okay, so very complex form is there. So that's why it is called, this is a process of quantum mechanical. Okay, where, so there's some positive energy, we say that, so that makes it either the neighboring electron either to couple parallel or anti-parallel. So this is what, okay, and like in, for example, in nickel oxide, okay, in nickel oxide, like now we have shown the diagram like this. So this is a nickel oxide diagram, overlapping where it takes place. So here what happens, super exchange of Ni plus 2 takes place, super exchange we call it here, of Ni plus 2 takes place, okay. So what happens here, so Ni plus 2, they have d electrons, okay, so they have nickel means d8 system, so they are having d8 electrons here, okay, in this in octahedral environment. Okay, so in octahedral environment, what happens, two of these occupy singly eg orbital. Okay, so two of these orbitals occupy singly eg orbital, that is your dz square and dx square minus y square. So this is what, dz square and e dx square minus y square. So electrons are occupied here, and these orbitals are oriented parallel to axis of the unit cell. Okay, so they are oriented parallel, these axes are, they are oriented in parallel, So this is important here in the unit cell. And the unpaired electrons in EG orbital, so as I said here, so unpaired electrons in EG orbital like this, okay, the unpaired electron in EG orbital coupled with electrons in P orbitals like this. They couple with the electrons of P, okay, P orbital. They couple with the electrons of the P orbital here, okay, of whom? For oxide. This is of nickel, okay, of oxide here. And this coupling may involve the formation of, so what happens, this coupling, whatever is happening here, they may involve the formation of excited state. They may involve the formation of excited state, okay, in which electron transfer, so in this what will happen, electron transfer from EG orbital of M plus to here to excited state, this to the P orbital of the oxide ion. Okay, so we may have the chances of taking place excitation of these electrons, forming a partial covalent bond, forming a partial covalent bond, okay, forming a partial covalent bond formation here, involving this electrons between adjacent nickel and oxide, okay, pairing of electrons between adjacent nickel and oxide. So this this happens here, which is a result of this covalent bond formation here. Okay, so the p orbital of O minus 2 here, so whatever the p orbital of O minus 2 ion is there, they contain two electrons each, okay, so in which are also coupled anti-parallel, so which are also coupled the anti-parallel we have seen here. So they also contain the two electrons which are coupling the anti-parallel like this, okay, so they are coupling also anti-parallel here, two electrons they are having, and they are also coupled anti-parallel, and a chain of coupling like this goes on, like this, okay, so it goes on, a chain coupling effect may occur, okay, like this. And the net effect is that, now what will be the net effect like this only, the net effect is that the neighboring Ni plus 2, so here separated by the intervening of the O minus 2, so neighboring Ni plus 2 is separated by the intervening of the O minus 2 ions, okay, which are coupled anti-parallel, like this, okay. So this is how the super exchange, we say, so phenomena, how it takes place in the case of nickel oxide. And we have learned this, they will ask in the examination. So whatever points I have told you, that you can mention or make a notes of these points. And this super exchange is very much important here. Today is what we have learned here. Infrequent, they will ask this question, mechanism of ferro and anti-ferro ordering, that is your super exchange. So first we learned the concept here, then we have learned regarding the with respect to one example, that is nickel oxide, where anti-ferromagnetic exchange, positive energy is making them to pair in anti-ferromagnetic manner, and you can see that it goes on like polymeric chain, where you can see everything is arranged in this anti-parallel, so that some positive energy is there which makes them to plane like that, to either parallel or anti-parallel. So this is what happens, and that process we call it as a super exchange. Followed by, we have learned today this all concepts of some of the magnetic behavior of these three ferromagnetic material, how they have the tendency to change their magnetic behavior at the respective temperature, that is your TC, that is Curie's temperature, as well as Neel temperature for the anti-ferromagnetic behavior. So this is how into today's video we have learned. Okay, next video we'll go for the next concept. So thank you very much.